Next talk is by Werner Fischer, 10 tips for better hardware monitoring. So, Werner, it's your stage. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay, so I hope, yes, everybody can hear me well. Microphone is on. I'm just a little bit surprised because the first time I only connected my laptop and I get a new VGA is not working. Connected the mini display port and I'm using Linux and it's magic, it just works. First time ever. So, yeah. Really, really nice. Okay, so welcome to you. Thanks for joining the talk about 10 tips for better hardware monitoring. I'll guide you the next 42 minutes until the next coffee break through 10 tips. And before we start, I have a question to you. Are you already monitoring your hardware right now? And by right now, I mean just today in this very moment, not I have planned it or I want to do it. Who of you is monitoring your hardware? Servers? Okay. Wow, that's about 60%. Who is not monitoring the hardware? Just to check. Okay, 10%, and I don't know what I'm... other 30% are doing. Okay. yeah, so I would say we can count that up. Let's say about... does this work here? Yeah, okay, about 80%, yes, and 20%. No, okay, I just want to come back at the end of it. So, regarding the technologies, now it's getting interesting. I've shown some technologies for hardware monitoring right here. So, question to you, who of you is using IPMI for hardware monitoring? Okay, about, I would say, 10, 15%. Let's put them in. Okay. Who of you is using SNMP? Oh, wow, about 40%, I would say. Who of you is using Redfish? Okay, that's not too much, but it's... It's not that surprising as there's currently no plugin for that around. It's very, very interesting, but I think that's the future maybe, but currently it's not, yeah, not broadly used, I would say. Who of you is using some local checks, for example, RAID or stuff like that, NRP or agents or stuff like that? Okay, again, about 20, 25%. And for this one, we don't need to have 100%. We can even have more as 100%. But I think, okay, I'm not sure. Who of you is using CAT? Pardon? Cat 5? Okay. Zero again. Okay, from these two technologies, which are currently not used, I hope that Redfish has better chances to be implemented indeed than CAT. But we will show in the future how the usage of Redfish can be. They are both based on some kind of animal technology, but Redfish is indeed one that can be used in the IT industry in the future. Okay, so that's the beginning. Now it gets a little bit further into the 10 tips. And I start with the very first and one of the most important tips. Even before you start to implement plugins in your environment, it's very important to know your hardware. And when I say know your hardware, although most of us don't want to spend a lot of time with the hardware, in fact, when you put a new server into action, you have the first and most of the time only chance to really take a look into the chassis, to look what's going on in there. In fact, when you running into problems a few years later, it's very good when you did this 5 or 10 extra minutes at the beginning, because it really makes things easier in the case that problems occur. So when we open the chassis, we look into the server and see, okay, there are lots of components in there. It, of course, depends how many servers you have in your environment. But example, in this case, we have a very common 2-unit in height server having about 8 disks. And here we're having, for example, three fans, then power supplies and stuff like that. And I say this because when you monitor the hardware stuff later on, it's very important to know, okay, how can I optimize my monitoring environment? For example, when it comes to the number of fans, you can configure, okay, I have three physical fans in there, so it's good to have at least three rotational parameters and see, okay, there are really three fans running in there. I say this because the standards which are behind the hardware monitoring stuff, be it SNMP or IPMI or Redfish, have really some open room. For example, when there are sensors on a system where there are no monitoring data, where there comes no monitoring data back, most of the sensors have this standardized information that they should say, okay, this sensor is not available and this is no problem. But in case you see there are three fans and you get only two numbers there, it is indeed a problem. So it's good to have this information in there. And of course, time goes on, your business is going bigger and bigger and bigger, and over time you have more and more servers, and at some point in date time you come up and so don't know what hardware is where and how can I configure this in a good way. So it's the best thing when you start with that to do it from the very beginning. So that's the first tip. Let's come to the second tip. Secure your baseboard management controller. And I renamed this from secure IPMI to secure your baseboard management controller because whether it is SNMP or IPMI you're using for hardware monitoring, you get the numbers from the so-called baseboard management controller. And that's a small chip located on every server mainboard. You see it here on the upper right side of the server, a small embedded ARM running an embedded Linux. Unfortunately, most of the time, this is a rather old Linux-based system with software, for example, from AMI or other vendors. The good news is that by now you can get the GPL sources, so you have the possibility to look into the code, but nevertheless, it's some 2.6.18 kernel or stuff like that, and it has some services on it like SNMP, like IPMI, like a web interface, and so on. And there have been quite some issue with the security of these devices in the past, and although there's a new standard coming up with Redfish to replace the commonly also often very unsecure IPMI, you still have this baseboard management controller, and it's very important to secure this component because it's no good news when you monitor your hardware, but on the other side, you open the doors to intruders and let them come into your server mainboard. And when you take a look at the picture, how it is working here, in the center we have this baseboard management controller providing the services like SNMP, IPMI, and stuff like that. It has a connection to the outside world via LAN interface, and on the other side via a system interface to the operating system which is running on the server. And you see it is connected to a lot of sensors. You have, for example, some fan sensors, temperature sensors, power controls and stuff like that. And you have really a good central point for monitoring the hardware, but on the other side you have also a central point which you have to secure. And there have been some news around about the security of these devices, although it's some years back in the past when the first security issues arise. This is a news from June 2014 where you see it has security, where a study has been published that about a quarter million servers have been reachable via the internet and can be very easily be hacked via this remote management interface. When you compare this, for example, if you would put one user server, so pizza boxes, one over the other and would stack it over each other, you would get more than 10 kilometers of a height. This is the number of servers which have been reached by this small study. So there are good chances that in case you did not configure your BMC right now, that maybe some ports may be open, and there's also a chance that, for example, although you don't know whether or not it has been configured, that maybe it's still configured with DHCP, and if you connect the LAN cable to the port, there's a service running up and you don't know it. And in addition to that, there are some issues of the IPMI specification. So for the standard to monitor the things, for example, in the first specification one, there's been really an authentication type none, which is really doing this, no authentication and do everything, which has been opened. And also with the new versions, there have been other security issues which you can close when you update your firmware. Or for this one, this is a hard one when it comes down to the encryption of passwords when they are sent over the network. There's really a shortcoming within the specification, because the specification mandates that when you know a username, for example, admin or root, that the BMC processor has to send a salted hash over the network before authentication has been done. And so when you have a normal NVIDIA graphic card, you doing some GPU things, you can easily get passwords when they're only 6, 7, or 8 characters long. So this brings me to 7 tips for this tip 2. So a small another tips for the top tip 2. To secure BMC, be sure to update your BMC's firmware. Use it on a separate network, be it a dedicated network or at least a VLAN. Deactivate unused services when you don't want to use, for example, web-based stuff or stuff like that, deactivate it. And use secure passwords and usernames. And this and username has the reason because, as mentioned, the specification mandates that a salted hash of a password can be sent to a known username. And when the username is as secure as a password should be, then there are good chances that you can hide your credentials very good. Monitor the things only with user rights, not with admin rights. So in case that someone would hack your monitoring box and grab passwords there, it's at least good when the hacker only can monitor your stuff and not switch off your servers. And configure your BMC's firewall if you have one present, and at the end of life, flash the firmware again or destroy the motherboard. So this is a very short overview to not be too long for the talk here. Just a few examples. Here for the LAN stuff, for example, when you buy a new server and you don't care about the BMC, for example, you only connect the onboard NICs here, you don't use this dedicated NIC for remote management. Normal way is that it's in a failover mode, meaning when there is no network connected here, the baseboard management controller says, okay, here on the first port, which is normally used by the operating system, there I have a link, so I'll switch the MAC address of my BMC to this one here. So I have a mini switch in there, bringing 2 MAC addresses on this port, and it has maybe DHCP configured. So in that case that you're having a DHCP server in your network, you automatically bring up the services without knowing it. So that's an important thing, to know your hardware, to know what it's doing, to be sure to know what happens. And then you can say, for example, I don't want to use this on the network, then configure it, for example, to the dedicated mode, and when you want to do the monitoring, do it via NRPE or the Icinga 2 agent to do the monitoring locally on the server, and then you have no open doors on the network. So these are the possibilities here, for example. And other things, as mentioned, update the firmware or only activate ports which are effectively using and stuff like that. So this was a very short introduction on the securing of the BMC, but it's very important because otherwise you open doors for hackers here. You find more details in a blog posting in German here, where I find the link in the slides later on. So, now we got to know how to secure the BMC. Next question is, how can we monitor these numbers? And as we got to new at the beginning, about 40% are using SNMP, about 25% are using IPMI. For those of you who are using SNMP, I want to show some of the advantages that you get when you're switching to IPMI instead of using SNMP. And I can say that IPMI, as it's an open specification, it's indeed implemented by every vendor. So it doesn't depend whether you have one of the vendors with a 2, 3, or 4 characters or servers from Thomas Crane, for example. You can monitor the servers without any dependency from the hardware vendor. And when it comes to IPMI, it has 4 main goals which it wants to fulfill. The first is to do the monitoring, which we'll take a closer look right now. Then you can do some recovery control, switch the server on or off, do some logging, and also do some inventory. And for the second one, doing a recovery control on, off, reset, for example, you have to put for sure the BMC to the network, so you cannot use any NRP stuff or things like that, because when the server is off, you cannot connect there. So that's, but for the monitoring stuff and the logging stuff, it doesn't matter. So when we take a look at the monitoring, we've already know that, for example, here in the upper right corner, there's the baseboard management controller. Here we have some sensors, for example, the fan sensors, the chassis intrusion sensor on the upper corner here, or the power supplies, for example. And by using IPMI, you have one big advantage, because although the security implementation isn't the best, you have very good sensor information. So there are 2 types of sensors, so-called discrete sensors and so-called threshold-based sensors. And this is really a nice thing, because for the discrete sensors, for example, they have a binary information attached, so they can have up to 16 flags, being 0 or 1, which are providing status information. So for example, for a power supply, a status can be presence has been detected, a failure has been detected, there may be a predictive failure, or the power supply lost its AC input. And it's very good to know whether or not the power supply has an internal failure, or it has lost its AC power on the outer side. And that's very valuable when you want to fix the issue. So we see we're having some kind of information here, but we cannot say a 0 is always good or a 1 is always good. For example, I want to have a presence, but I don't want to have a failure detected or a power supply AC lost here. So we have to look into that a little bit more in detail. But for the other sensors, for the threshold-based sensors, like fan sensors, temperature sensors, the baseboard management controller has already some values stored here. For example, critical thresholds for lower or upper numbers, depending on the sensor. So the BMC itself knows whether or not the number which is currently being read on the sensor is good or is not good. And this makes it easy for us to monitor the sensor, so we don't have to use, for example, SNMP and say, okay, I want to have a fan number between 1,000 and 5,000, because the range is already within the BMC, and we see, okay, for example, when we have things like system temperature or peripheral temperature, we have a reading, and we also have this upper thresholds then in the back, so that's very easy to implement. And the other thing is regarding this discrete sensors, where the issue is, okay, is this a good status, is this not a good status? And there are good possibilities when you're using free IPMI, the free IPMI tools of the GNU project in the background, because this set of tools has a configuration file behind it with some standard information for all the about 1,000 binary options which are in the specification. So you don't have to configure, okay, presence is good, but AC lost is not good. It's already in there, but you can override it if you want to in the configuration file. So the good news here is when you're using free IPMI in the background, you just have to switch on the plugin, maybe optimize it to say, okay, I want to have three fan sensors in there, and you're fine. And that's also been the reason why we ported the plugin, which was based on IPMI tool in the past, to free IPMI some years ago, because it has this kind of information, which makes it a lot much easier to monitor your hardware. And yeah, if you want to check it out, just go to github.com/ThomasGren and download the Check IPMI sensor plugin. It's already also in packages on Debian and Ubuntu, for example, on the Nagios plugins contrib package. So if you're using Debian or Ubuntu, just do an apt-get install Nagios plugins contrib, and you have the plugin in there too. And the most current version can be found on GitHub there. And yeah, how does it look like when you execute it, for example, on a host? You can put the credentials in a configuration file. This has the advantage that the username password does not show up in the process list of the system, so that's the most secure way to do it. You can say, okay, I want to have the serial number of the server within the status output of the plugin. So in case I'm running into some issues, I already get the serial number of the server and can contact my vendor. I have a problem with this serial number, and then I can do a faster RMA, for example. And here we are seeing with a very verbose output, not only the performance data for the threshold-based plugins, but also the status of the discrete plugins there. So a lot of information here. And if you want to optimize it, add an option to the number of fans. To say, for example, for this pizza box, I only have one fan, but in case of a server with three fans, put in three fans there, then you are already in a good situation there too. And this is one of the reasons why I mentioned the tip number one: know your hardware. So 20 minutes left. We have already started with monitor your IPMI sensors, and in the last 12 months, we added another thing: monitor your system event log too. So when you take a look at the four things we want to get with IPMI, not only monitor your normal sensors, monitor also your system event log. And there's also a simple reason for that, why this is a good idea. Because there are some components, for example, a CPU or also the memory modules, which do not have normal IPMI or SNMP sensors for example, fault or error states. And the most popular example for this is when there are ECC errors occurring on memory modules, because this is not the sensor state where I say, okay, the module is broken, this is the information, the kind of, for example, warning, you're getting an correctable memory error on the stim. And as you can see here, in this recent example, when you see, okay, I have one error here on the February 3rd, then I have one on the 13th, then two on the 14th, and you see, okay, maybe the errors are getting more and more, then you have here time to say, okay, I have here correctable ECC errors, maybe it would be wise to keep an eye on that, and in case that they are getting more and more and more, there are good chances that the module could break in the future, so maybe I should watch out and prepare a spare replacement for that. But it really depends here on how often these errors occur. I could give another 1 or 2 hours of information on memory errors. It really depends on your on the services that you are running, how you are using the memory, how often you are writing on it. This really has a big influence in how often these errors occur. And on the other side, you're getting also other information here, for example, audit information when someone wants to connect to the system and you're getting a wrong username or password. And how this can be done really depends on your server. It varies from vendor to vendor and also sometimes from machine to machine. So we've added some functions in there. It's been in the last October, I think, or something like that. We've added some options for the monitoring of the system event log. For example, you can limit the type of sensors you want to monitor with the system event log, for example, to memory and processor, or you can exclude some sensors, for example, when you open the chassis more often, you don't want to get some kind of intrusion alerts or stuff like that. This would be a wise idea. I can even exclude individual entries. This is important because, for example, when you're getting normal errors for fans or stuff like that, where you have already an information in the normal monitoring stuff, you are also getting information in there. So by time over time, you see, okay, how you can tune this to have the optimized output there. And then you have a really good position because when you configure this once, how it fits to you, you have really good chance that you get to know every error which occurs in the future. And so you see, we are constantly updating this plugin, and as it's on GitHub, just open issue if you have a wish here, and we try to implement it. So I have to be a little bit faster. There are also some servers which don't have IPMI or BMC on board. Most of the time, these are smaller boxes, like things like this one, without any fans, without any big power need, for example, 10 watts. So they often don't have BMCs on board. But for these systems, it's also good to monitor the sensors. So they just use LM sensors. Go into the BIOS, look, okay, what sensors are there around, install LM sensors, run sensors detect, and run the plugin, which comes already with the monitoring plugins, from the monitoring plugins project, and then yeah, count your values. And this is also a very good idea because, especially for these boxes, they don't have any active cooling, but in case that, for example, you have issues with your cooling in the data center and it's summer, for example, and it's getting warmer and warmer and warmer, it's also good to know when it's getting too warm for the server, when it's a good time to fix your cooling in the data center. At my home location, I see very good when I open the window and when I close the window in wintertime, but unfortunately, I didn't have a screenshot there. So that's the first 5 tips. Now we come to the other 5 tips in the next 14 following minutes. Who of you is monitoring your weight? Okay. Who of you is using a weight? Okay, so more people are monitoring their weight as they are using it. Okay. When you're using weight systems, it depends on the server whether or not you get information about the weight status already within the BMC. So for some A-brands, for example, you have the possibility to get a status of the drive, the status of the weight controller within the BMC. That's good because you don't have to add any other checks within your operating system. But on the other side, there are still lots of other sensors on the weight cards which are good to know, which might not be in this information on the BMC. So for that reason, we took a look at all the components which might be involved when you have a weight setup. And here it comes down to hardware weight. For software weight, you can do the normal weight check with the checks from the monitoring plugins. When it comes down to hardware weight, you have a hardware weight controller. You have some drives or SSDs, and you also often have some kind of cache protection, be it a battery backup unit, a BBU, or nowadays a cache vault module, or for AdapTech, it's called ZCMP, where you have a flash memory on it, and when a power loss occurs, the data from the RAM here is written to the flash, and you protect your white cache on there. And for that reason, we also provide two plugins, one for the LSI-based weight controller cards, then called Avago Megarate, now called Broadcom Megarate, but the plugin still is called check LSI weight. It works for all of the controllers, be it directly one from Broadcom or be it that it is a controller from some A brands which are based on this chip, and also for the Adaptec stuff. And when I take a look at the GitHub page there, you see that it's indeed a little bit more than only taking a look at the drives and the RAID controller itself. There is a lot of information about the RAID controller there, be it temperature, be it information about the drives, be it information about the logical device status, be it information about media errors, smart flags, or stuff like that, or be it information about the battery backup or the cache vault module, because these are often have sensors like, again, temperature, and these are things that you don't get from your BMC. But this is also an information which is very important, because especially if you have some older servers which are using a BBU, it's good to monitor this kind of stuff, because the battery in there is getting worse and worse over time, like you know it from your laptop when it's getting a few years old. After some time, you cannot work for 6 hours, you work for 4 hours, for 3 hours, and it's the same for this battery backup models here. And this is very important, because when you have a power outage, for example, during the night, and it only works for 2 hours, and then it loses its information, you maybe lose your weight. And for that reason, it's a very good idea to monitor this here. And the same is true for Adaptec RAID controllers. You have also features in there like for the LSI MegaRAID based ones. And as a side note, when you're using RAID controllers with hard drives, it's a good idea to have this cache protection, like a cache vault module or a battery backup unit. When it comes to SSD RAIDs, it might be often the case that it is indeed faster when you deactivate the write cache of the RAID controller, and then you don't need a cache vault module. So it really makes sense to look at the SSD RAID, whether or not you need some kind of write cache in there. Write cache is only helping when you're doing streaming I/O for random I/O most of the time. It's not that fast. We are doing some research on there with another open source tool, TakerPerf. We are running now RAID tests since the beginning of January. We now tested all the scenarios for MegaRAID, and now testing soft RAID, and we'll provide the data within 1 or 2 months in the wiki. So, but back to monitoring, back to the last 10 minutes for the session. You already monitor your RAID. Who of you is using some other kind, like software-defined storage, Ceph, or other solutions, ZFS? Okay, also a few of you. So the good news to you is you don't need to monitor your RAID controller. And the other good news is you can still monitor stuff on at your side. And there, SMART comes into play. SMART is the self-monitoring, analytic, and reporting technology. It has been introduced a lot of years ago. And it's really cool to use it to monitor your hard drives, and especially your SSDs. And there are good news. SMART has a standardized data format, has standardized commands, has standardized error logs and tests. And the bad news is that it hasn't standardized attributes. So for the attributes on the right side, the bad news is that depending on your vendor, depending on the model, the numbers may be different to interpret and maybe hard to monitor. And for that reason, we started to develop another plugin, the Check Smart Attributes plugin, which is also at the GitHub page. It works rather easily. You just execute it, put the device name on there, and add some database file. It's indeed only a small JSON file, which has information about all the drives that we are currently monitoring, all the models. And then you get out the information whether or not it is OK. And you get, in addition, some performance data. And some more detailed data here. And how does this work? It works in a way that we have information for each model in there. So when it comes, for example, to SSDs, We have here some very interesting values, for example, the media wearout indicator. This is the number which gives the information to you how the health status of your flash cells is in there. And this number may faster get lower when you're using the SSD as a write cache, for example. Normally, it's a value in percentage, so 100% is good. And when you're doing more and more writes, it may get down, down, and down. And here we configure, for example, okay, when it comes down to 16% here at the back, we say, okay, we put a warning in there. Maybe you should keep an eye on that. When it comes to 11%, okay, it maybe get critical and you have to keep an eye on that. And the good news is that although 11% can sound critical, it depends really on the drive, whether or not how long it will still survive. There's been some tests from the Heise group where we've seen, for example, SSDs for data centers where they've still been working when they got 1%. So normally the guarantee is based on terabytes written for a device. And the good news is that in case you don't use it as an really, really hardly, intensively used write device, you can use it 5 years or longer. And at the end, you're still getting performance data in there. So that's the good news, we have information in there. The bad news, again, is that there are coming new SSDs, new hard drives each month, and how about these things? How we can you cope with that? The good news is that, thank Git, it's Christmas, you can just take a wish, get on github.com and open an issue on there, and we will look at the device and add it, and then it should work smoothly. So this is also a good example where open source is just a nice, fine thing. You don't have to implement it yourself, just open an issue, say, okay, this is my device, I want to monitor it, we'll take a look at it, and this really works out well. So 5 more minutes left. One question that might come up here is when you have a weight controller, have you the chance to monitor the smart information there in this detail too or not? What do you think? The controller is giving some basic information whether or not smart is saying yes, I'm good or not. But this may not be always be the best information because it depends on the attributes. Do you think that you can monitor the attributes for behind the weight controller? Who of you is thinking yes? Who of you is thinking no? Who of you is still awake? Okay, coffee time, okay. The good news is it's possible. So even for LSI-based and adaptive weight, you can still monitor the attributes and there to be on the really safe side, and this works out just fine. And to prove it, here you see, okay, I'm having a SSD in a weight behind the weight controller, and it's giving me the ECC error count in there, so I see, okay, this is indeed working, and I have good news on there. So, how about VMware? Is some of you using VMware? Okay, wow, about 40%. So there you have also possibility to monitor your hardware very easily. The best thing is look out for the SIM provider for your hardware. For example, when you're having an LSI-based card, install a SIM provider there, and you get the information in there. In addition, with the IPMI sensors there, so you can then just check out and use, for example, a Check A6i hardware plugin or the Check VMware plugin and monitor these sensors there with the SIM module. And yeah, for the VMware, Check VMware plugin, there's also a recording of a talk from the open source monitoring conference from Martin Rose Fürstenau, who implemented the plugin there. And for the hardware plugin, you can find details on the wiki there. For the hardware plugin, the bad news is that since ESXi 5.1, you cannot configure local groups on the individual ESXi host, so you have to get to the command line of the server when you don't want to use the root ESXi account, which we hardly, strongly recommend. So just take a look at the information on the wiki to get to know how to implement this. So 2 minutes, 10 seconds left. Yeah, I got to know you want to have coffee, so I don't want to be the one who is the root cause for that. Who of you is using GPU cards? Okay, one, two. Okay, there's a plugin for that around two on the plugin side there already. It's a little bit old, 1 or 2 years, so in case you run into problems, please just open an issue. I recommend to the two of you to monitor your temperature here. In fact, when we developed the plugin back 4 years ago, we went into problems about the fan. I think there's some fan sensor in there. Temperature memory lock. Fan speed, yeah, fan speed sensor. And we noticed, okay, when the fan is not rotating, it still shows these numbers. And then we asked on the developer forum there, and they said, yeah, that's not the number that the sensor is running at, that's the number of which the card is trying to run the sensor at. and I just wanted to add the link to the forum in there in the slides, but unfortunately the forum is not on at this URL anymore, and I haven't found it on archive.org. So also a good tip when you want to document something on the web, just go to archive.org, enter the URL, and say if it's not archive, archive now, and 3 years later you can still refer to that. And that's the reason why I didn't put it in the slides here, because I cannot prove it again, but yeah. So the tip is here, really monitor your temperature. When the fan isn't working, the temperature will go up and you will notice it there. So 1 minute, 15 seconds left for the last tip, and the last tip is very easy. Start with tip number one, know your hardware, secure your BMC, whether or not you use IPMI, get the plugins and configure it, and relax, enjoy your coffee, and if you have any questions, please ask.
Other questions? Can you repeat the question, please?
When you read the smart attributes of the hard disk, does it have any influence of the performance of the hard disk? For smart, I can say that we haven't noticed any performance issue when reading the smart values on there. But it's a good question when it comes down to weight controllers. For the weight plugins, we noticed with the MegaWeight plugin that when we used the first option, show all, it really had an influence on the performance. And we got in contact with the developers of the firmware and then changed the monitoring using the store CLI in there and changed the parameters, now using parameters which do not have an influence on that. We still have an issue on that with adaptive weight controllers, with older ones, for example, Series 6 or so. We were also taking a focus on how we can optimize it so it don't have an influence on there.
Are your plugins also available for the Windows servers?
The question is, are there plugins also available for Windows servers? We have tested them with Windows servers when you are using Strawberry Pearl, for example, and there are also articles on the Thomas Krenn Wiki how to run them on Windows Server 2012, and we've also tested it, I think, with Windows Server 2016. So you have to install Strawberry Pearl, and then they are running. And NS Client Plus Plus, yeah. Any more? Yes? The question is, with Free IPMI, who is actually developing the parameters? The main developer of Free IPMI is Albert Chu from the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory in the United States. He's running, I think, 4,000, 5,000 servers or something like that. And he's optimized the software to scale with this number of servers. So you can also deploy them, power them up and down. He's a very active developer. You can join the mailing list in case you're running into any issues. Just ask a question there, and he's very open. And the good news is that he gets paid for maintaining this. So, yes?
Yeah. Maybe you can show us a few feature limits it to the bright feature we are expecting.
Yeah, the question is about redfish. I have mentioned it, but I haven't shown details on it. The main reason why I haven't shown details on it yet is there's no plugin currently available for this. It's running on the same BMC, so if you're having a server and updating your firmware, there are good chances that you're getting the redfish standard as an add-on. You can use it in a REST kind of way, so you're having a simple HTTPS interface that you can use. The reason why there's no plugin already around is that with IPMI you can just send one query and get all information back. With Redfish, you have to do some interactions, so you can grab, okay, what components are around, then get the answer back, and then say, okay, I want to monitor this and this and this. So we have do a little bit of ping pong, and we are keeping an eye on that, of course. But right now, there's no plugin available. Hopefully, maybe there's a talk next year or in 2 years or so about the new cool features of the Redfish plugin. And there are also recordings of the open source data center conference. They had a talk about Redfish where you can find details in 45 minutes about Redfish. And you can come to our booth there. So I think if there are any more questions, just come down to the booth. Also, just fill out some sheet and win one of these servers to monitor your environment. Just put on your name and be here at in the last break at 4 p.m. You don't have to provide your email address, as we are giving the prize away right now. We don't need your address, only your name, and that's it.
Thank you very much, Werner.